Hello, welcome back. This is Victor Magariño, and today we're continuing our series on the classical political economy, specifically on our first episode, which was dedicated to the study of Say's law, also known as the law of markets. And we began our last episode by describing what the theory is, the different meanings of it, and today we're going to get to the criticisms. We're going to begin with Keynes and what his views on this were. Even though Keynes is not a classical economist, I'm going to argue that he was influenced by some of the classical economists who were critical of this theory, and his criticism really set a basis for a new way of thinking economics, the breaking, link from the classical tradition, one of the breaking links. So it is an important thing to keep in mind. And in our next video, we're going to look at Marxist criticism, who had, I'm going to argue, a position that is better, it's more complete, and looks more in depth on the problem than what Keynes and the other classical economists that were critical of Say's law did. So allow me to begin by presenting the figure of Keynes, who he was, why his criticism matters, and the different contributions that he has made to the theory, or to economic theory. So Keynes was a famous British economist living in the between the 19th and 20th century. He was born in 1883 and died in 1946, right after the end of the Second World War. And he's well known in economics for presenting, especially in macroeconomics, for presenting different models. Specifically, he is well known for his work on multipliers, for his model of the aggregate supply and aggregate demand. He's well known because he set the basis for some of the important policy decision making in the 20th century. And his criticism really set, to the classical economists, really set what we can call a revolution. In fact, it's well known in academia that what Keynes set himself to do and what he did after the publication of his main work, which is the General Theory of Interest Rate and Employment and Money, in 1936, what he really did was a revolution known as the Keynesian Revolution, which started to look at economics in a different way. And this has implications also for the Marxist tradition in economics, because some of the things that the Keynesian tradition does, focuses on, are also ignoring, it's also a way of ignoring the advances that Marx made. In fact, a lot of people think that the reason why Keynes was so popular was because he was able to improve over what the classicals hadn't been able to do, and he included certain things that were able to make capitalist societies better, and so on and so forth. But it's something amongst Marxists, we tend to think that, and I think this is a quite reasonable thing to say, that really what made Keynes and the Keynesian economic tradition so popular was its implications, in that it meant that you could solve capitalist problems, the problems of capitalism, within the capitalist framework, which is something that the Marxist tradition has always been against. We don't think that you can solve the deeper contradictions of capital, and Keynes really set, you know, a path through which people thought that they could manage to, in fact, control capitalism. Even though Keynes didn't really think that you could control capitalism, that the government was just there to make some corrections and to supplement the market, but this led people to think that you could, in fact, set a humane capitalism just by government spending and by looking at aggregate demand and these sorts of issues that Keynes spoke about. And so Keynes's work, The General Theory, in which he criticizes the classicals and especially Say's law, is important because before him, this law, the law of markets, was widely accepted in the orthodox economic theory, and it was really after Keynes, and this is something that has been noted by many economic historians for being quite remarkable thing, that right after the publication of that book, not too long after, this theory was completely abandoned. And even today in academia, especially in undergraduate level, it's not really something that people look at anymore. The law of markets, Say's law, and the classical tradition in general have been quite ignored ever since. And one of the things that is important to notice here is that Keynes had a definition of the classical economists that was quite idiosyncratic, because he basically considered classical economics to be all economics before him, when in reality, this, let's say, the move towards a new theory of economics had already been done, especially after 1871 with the marginalist revolution and Walras and all of these economists that we are also going to be looking in this channel at some point or another. But the main idea here is the classical economics is not really what Keynes described it to be, because there had already been some, let's say, breaking points that had occurred before him. But what he's doing in with Say's law is really criticizing the originators of this theory, which were John Stuart Mill, so the actual classical economists. So then what were Keynes's influences? And here, this is an important thing to notice, because he's going to take the notions of a lack of effective demand and of savings as some sort of leakage from the economy that Malthus and Sismondi had already presented in their very famous debates with David Ricardo, especially Malthus. And Malthus is of special importance to Keynes. And this is something that almost all scholars I have looked at agree, that Keynes looked particularly in-depth at this debate in the classical tradition between Malthus and Ricardo, beginning in the 1930s and especially in 1932. And Keynes really took Malthus as some sort of a genius, because he was one of the, you know, outliers. He was one of the critics of this theory that was widely accepted. And even though he has admitted that Malthus didn't really present a proper alternative explanation of crisis, he said that it was in fact true that he had already some good notions about what demand and the leakages from the economy were. So Malthus was trying to explain the crisis that followed the Napoleonic Wars, and he was arguing with David Ricardo on exactly what the cause of this crisis, of the different crises that happened in Britain and so on and so forth, were. And he had this notion. First of all, the theory of value that Malthus presented was different from David Ricardo's, because David Ricardo, as well as Marx, had a theory of value where value was the amount of labor embodied in commodities, whereas for Malthus, it had to do more with the value, the labor that commodities could command. And so this is a major distinction here, because in a sense, David Ricardo already admitted this, if you take the notion of value of Malthus, in a sense, crises are built into the system, right? So there's no way of escaping crises if you accept Malthus's definition of value. But the main thing for Ricardo is, look, I don't accept your theory of value. I think that mine reflects the reality of capitalism more deeply, and it doesn't contradict the Say's law, which was one of the principal tenets. So Ricardo ended up really winning over the debate, and by 1848, with the advances done by John Stuart Mill and so on, this debate was pretty much over. No one after that year was trying to make the case against these economists until Keynes and his general theory in 1936. So now that we know what Keynes's main influences were, let's get to the actual criticism, and to begin with it, let's look at one of the quotes that I took from the general theory, specifically in chapter 2, where he states the following about Say's law. He says, "From the time of Say and Ricardo, the classical economists have taught that supply creates its own demand, meaning by this, in some significant but not clearly defined sense, that the whole of the costs of production must necessarily be spent in the aggregate, directly or indirectly, on purchasing the product." Now, what Keynes is really doing here is present the theory in one simple line, which is supply creates its own demand. And this is not entirely true, and this is why one of the reasons why I claim that Keynes's criticism was not really that good, or not really as good as Marx's, because what he wants to do by presenting the theory in one simple line is say that what the classicals were doing is ignore the reality of capitalism by ignoring the fact that crises, general gluts, occur. What he's mainly saying there is, look, on the assumption of full employment, it may certainly be true that Say's law holds to some extent, but since the economy is most of the time not at full employment, then Say's law doesn't make sense almost in all of capitalist history. And this is really not a proper representation of the theory, because as we already saw in the last video, the theory has many different meanings, almost by the extended version of it would be 8 meanings, and it does accept, in those meanings, it is accepted that general gluts can occur. What the classicals were saying is that what Keynes is going to present as the cause of crisis, which is a lack of effective demand that comes from different sources, but that's for after we comment on this. The lack of effective demand is not the cause, it's rather the consequence. We observe it, but it is not what really leads the crisis, leads an economy to crisis. So let's look at John Stuart Mill, one of his quotes, where he makes this a little bit more clear. In his Principles of Political Economy, John Stuart Mill says the following: "I have already described the state of the markets for commodities which accompanies what is termed a commercial crisis. At such times, there is really an excess of all commodities above the money demand. In other words, there is an undersupply of money. From the sudden annihilation of a great mass of credit, everyone dislikes to part with ready money, and many are anxious to procure it at any sacrifice. Almost everybody, therefore, is a seller, and there are scarcely any buyers, so that there may really be, though only while the crisis lasts, an extreme depression of general prices from what may be indiscriminately called a glut of commodities or a dearth of money." So here John Stuart Mill, as well as the other classical economists who supported Say's law, is really accepting the existence of general gluts. And he had, as we already saw, this theory where partial gluts, due to miscalculations done by entrepreneurs or by other external factors, but the main key idea here is that it is only external factors. It's not really something that the system itself produces, but crises are external to it. They are not endogenous, they're rather exogenous. So from exogenous variables, you can get partial gluts that can lead to general gluts, but that in any case, it is never some lack of demand that is in a sense built into the system, but rather certain aspects of the world that simply affect the economy without the economy being to blame for it. So then Keynes is going to use this definition that he presented of Say's law in order to suggest that the classicals were wrong, first because they ignored the reality of capitalism and the reality of crisis, of general gluts. But as we've seen, he's not entirely right on this point. However, he needs to make this point because what he's going to suggest now is that crises do in fact occur, and he's going to subrepetitiously include his own notion of how crises occur, which is a lack of effective demand. And one of the reasons he gives for this crisis, for the lack of effective demand, is savings. And he's going to say that, unlike what the classicals, what some of the classicals had said, and what classicals in his definition, and what other economists had said about savings being equalized with investment through the interest rate, what he's going to suggest is that there is really not a mechanism by which investment and savings become equal, and if there is not such mechanism, then savings becomes some sort of a leakage from the economy. Money, as you save it, is not spent on anything, it's not invested, therefore it moves outside of the economy and it creates the possibility, not only the possibility, but it actually leads to crises. And this story that Keynes is saying is not really wrong, because, and Marx already accepted it, that the fact that the classicals were making this oversimplification by saying that commodities exchange against each other through the mediating role of money, as if money was just a bail, as if commodities really exchanged against each other. And this might seem true at the aggregate level, at the level of the aggregate, in the circular flow model, for example, this might be true. But in reality, and Marx already noticed this, as I said before, there is a dual nature in exchange, which arises from the fact that commodities, use values, before they become, before they are exchanged, they first need to be turned into money, into an exchange value, in order to be exchanged against another use value. So this dual nature, and Keynes didn't have this specific criticism, but he did suggest that you can in fact hold money instead of just spending it, right? The only thing is that Keynes, as well as Malthus and Sismondi, posited this to be the cause of crisis, whereas Marx is going to say that this opens up the possibility, it's a formal possibility for crisis, but Marx is not really going to say that this is the cause. He's going to say that the causes are different and are deeper, and this is then the main difference, I think, here between the Keynesian, you know, Malthus's criticism to Say's Law and Marx's, because the notion of savings as a leakage from the economy is presented by Keynes as the cause, whereas for Marx it's presented as a formal possibility of crisis. And it's important to highlight this because it is in fact the case that, for example, as other economists, Keynesian economists, have suggested, inequality, an unequal distribution of purchasing power, creates the possibility of crisis. Now, for Marx, even though it creates the possibility of crisis, it is not the cause. The cause has to do with profitability, and it has to do with the decreasing, the tendency of the rate of profit to decrease. However, for Keynes, this really is the cause, not just what opens up the possibility, what triggers, in a sense. It's rather the cause, and this is what the classicals were denying, the fact that these things were causes. They were, in a sense, the effects of the crisis, but not the cause. And furthermore, pretty much like Malthus, Keynes really didn't explain crisis successfully. He didn't really explain why there are lacks of effective demand. He had, you know, this notion of animal spirits in investors, and that suddenly if confidence disappears, then people start holding their money, and then that holding becomes a leakage. But he didn't really have a systematized notion of how crises occurred, pretty much like Malthus. So what he did really in the general theory was present solutions for the crisis, a wide variety of solutions, but never really give the kind of proper deep explanation of crisis that we would expect, and that in fact Marx had, which he took. Marx took his notion of crisis from the classical tradition, from the classicals, who accepted Say's law. And this is why Marx's criticism is more complex and a bit better, because it accepts Say's law when it makes sense, but it denies it when it doesn't, and it shows how even within the framework of Say's law, it is still possible to have crisis because of profitability, something that Keynes really ignored. And Malthus already had a notion of a decreasing rate of profit, but for him, as I said before, because of his theory of value, it was in a sense built into the system, and the tendency of the rate of profit to fall for Malthus was due to, again, a lack of demand, you know, savings and excessive savings and so on. So in reality, even though they had good notions when it came to criticizing the simplicity of Say's law when it comes to the description of how commodities are exchanged against each other, as in a sense as they are assuming barter, right? As if commodities just exchange against one another without money, as if just money was there, had just the mediating role but nothing else. And they were right to point out that it is a bit more complex, and money in fact plays an important role. And by holding money, you can create the circumstances that can make what is a formal possibility an actuality, which is what Marx held to be true. However, they didn't really have the deeper notion about crisis that Marx did have, and that we're going to look more in depth in our next video. So this is it for now. I hope you enjoyed it. As you can always leave comments. I always appreciate them, and support me by subscribing, liking, sharing it with other people. And thank you very much for watching. I will see you in the next video.